Hello, I'm Dr. Q. Welcome to my channel. This is the second class of Principles of Economics. I'll cover rational behavior, total and marginal utility, marginal analysis, and sunk cost. Before the beginning of the new material, let's do a quick review of last class. In Lecture 1, we discussed that because the resources are desirable and limited, when facing multiple options, we have to pick one alternative over another. The value associated with the best foregone alternative is the opportunity cost of the chosen one. And generally speaking, we want to minimize the cost and maximize the value when making a decision. When that is true, we say the behavior is rational or purposeful. The idea is very intuitive and true to all social identities in general. Consumers want to pay the least price for the best product or service, or get most goods or service with the least budget. That's why there are all types of apps and tools helping people to find deals. Businesses want to maximize the profit with the least cost. Sometimes that could result in business relocation from move overseas to chase for cheaper labor or lower tax. If people care about their self-interest, want to maximize their benefit and act accordingly, in economics we have a name called rational behavior or purposeful behavior. They are exchangeable. Please note that people care about self-interest when they make a decision, but it does not mean that there is always a desirable outcome. Because unforeseeable situation or asymmetric information also plays a role. For example, we always pick the shortest line to wait for being checked out in grocery store or bank. But being helped first is not guaranteed. The computer may break down in your line, or there's a consumer in front of you demands more time. The business makes a sound decision in production, but the policy or other influencing factors may change. So the project may not turn out to be profitable. But as long as people care about self-interest and want to make an optimal decision, we say they're rational. Now, let's focus on individual behaviors first. I'd like to make a quick clarification about an economic term, utility. In daily life, utility means services like supply of water, electricity, etc. In economics, utility refers to the satisfaction, enjoyment, or happiness one gets from consuming a good or service. I love donuts and I eat one. I'm happy. I cannot start my day without a cup of coffee in the morning. I'm satisfied after drinking my coffee. Other things like watching a movie or a game, listening to music, can all provide us enjoyment or happiness. In economics, we just use the new term utility as opposed to happiness or satisfaction. Please note that, first of all, utility is different from usefulness, at least sometime. Nobody likes going to the dentist. Consuming the dental service provides no happiness or enjoyment, but it's useful, and you probably will be happy later. The same rationale applies to other medical treatment. On the other hand, cigarette, drug, excessive alcohol use is not useful and actually harmful. However, can bring enjoyment to people, and therefore there's utility in consuming and people would like to pay for them. Secondly, Utility is a subjective term. I love peanut butter and I'm happy eating a peanut butter sandwich. But my cousin is allergic to peanut. Taking peanut butter sandwich will make her sick. That's negative utility. Thirdly, people care about self-interest does not necessarily mean that they are selfish. During the pandemic, I buy and use personal protective equipment to minimize the chance of getting my parents or other people infected, and I feel good about it. I'm happy. I help the senior neighbors shop for groceries, and I'm glad about my altruism. Happiness or utility may be obtained both through material or non-material means. Lastly, happiness, satisfaction, or utility is difficult to quantify. Nobody says that, I'm at level 5 of happiness after eating a donut, or I'm at level 10 of happiness after watching a game, or anything. We say, I like a donut, or it's a great game. But the crazy economists manage to come up a measurement of unit for happiness, satisfaction, or utility. It's called util. As we said, it's odd to quantify the happiness. But just imagine that you're in your doctor's office, and they make you fill up questionnaires before seeing the doctor, asking from 0 to 10, rank how much pain are you experiencing. Imagine that rational when you use util to measure your happiness or utility. To make sure you grasp measuring utility, let's imagine a specific consumption. Eating donuts. Because I love donuts, and excuse me if you're indifferent, please just bear with me. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the Krispy Kreme challenge. Let me brief you on that. Every winter at North Carolina State University, there's a Krispy Kreme challenge. It's a student-run event. There's participants to dash 2.5 miles from the bell tower, eat 12 donuts, and then, with stomachs bursting, finish with another 2.5 mile run back to their starting point, all in 1 hour. The event is an NC State tradition to raise money for the University of North Carolina Children's Hospital. Please have a wild guess how many people can make it without puking. Let's forget about the run. Just imagine that there's a dozen of nice, fresh donuts in front of you. You get to enjoy them peacefully with a cup of coffee. When you eat a donut one by one, think about the happiness associated with each one. Let's log our data for analysis. Let's use the first column to specify the total number of donuts I eat. So the variable name is number of donuts consumed. The second column represents the utility or happiness associated with eating each donut. We call it extra utility gained. Before I eat any donut, the number is 0 and there is no utility related. The first donut tastes so good. Eating it makes me feel so happy, and I think I gained 10 utils of happiness. Then I eat another one. The second one tastes good, but I wouldn't say it's as good as the first one, you know. The first bite always tastes the best. So I give it an 8. And I eat the third one, gives me utility of 6 utils. The fourth one is 4. And the fifth one, oh yes, I can eat 5 donuts, gives me 2 utils of utility. At this point, I think I'm good. But I managed to eat another one. The sixth one. I won't say this one makes me happy. It's a stretch for me to swallow it. And that generates no happiness for me. So it's 0. After the sixth, I really cannot eat anymore. And another one definitely makes me sick. I will throw up. If we want to quantify the unpleasant feeling, I will give it a negative 2. Now, I want to replace the variable name for the second column with an economic term. We know the numbers represent the extra happiness or utility gained out of eating the corresponding additional donut. In economics, we give the extra related to another one a special name called marginal. Marginal is an important term as we're going to use very often in future, and marginal analysis is very essential in making optimal decisions. Give you another example about marginal. If there are 3 people now in the elevator and another person joins them, the marginal weight borne by the elevator is the weight of the 4th person. And a quick side talk. There is actually an interesting relationship between average and marginal. Example, if I have a class of 50 students, take an exam, and I want to calculate the average score, then summing up everyone's score and divide the summation by the number of participants is the approach I'm using. Let's say the average is, hypothetically, 85. Now imagine we have another student, 51st student join our class from another session, with a score of 90. Then the marginal score associated with the 51st student is 90. After averaging his performance, the overall average will be pulled up a little bit. But if we have another student coming with a score of 60, the marginal score of the 51st student will be 60, and he or she will pull the average down. The rationale will be further discussed in the firm theory, but let's go back to our donut example. Given what I discussed, we can rephrase the extra utility gained in second column as marginal utility. Now let's illustrate the relationship with a graphical expression. We got a graph looks like this. We can easily say that the line is downward sloping, which means from left to right as the horizontal axis value getting larger, which means more donuts eaten, the vertical value, which is the marginal utility, declines. We call it a negative or indirect relationship. Of course, this is my data, and my data for the marginal utility happened to conveniently decrease by a constant number. Your data can be and probably will be different from mine based upon how much you enjoy eating donuts and your scale of utils. But it's a safe guess that your data will also provide a downward sloping graph, means actual happiness out of keep eating donut decreases. This is known as the law of diminishing marginal utility. Now let's think about total utility. Total utility is more intuitive. When you have no doughnut, the total utility you have is none. One doughnut gives you 10 utils. When you eat two, the two together give you 10 from the first, 8 from second, so 18 utils in total. The first three give you 10 plus 8 plus 6, 24 in total. If we keep going, these are the values associated. We can also graph the relationship between doughnut number and the total utility. By putting the total utility graph with the marginal utility curve on the same two-dimensional axis set, there are some interesting findings. The two curves start at the same point. As value for total and marginal are the same, when first doughnut is eaten. Then marginal utility declines, but as long as it's positive above the horizontal axis, total utility increases, just with a decreasing rate. So this is not a straight line over here. The decreasing rate is essentially marginal utility. Then, at the sixth doughnut, marginal utility is zero and total utility achieves its peak. When marginal utility is negative, the total value finally declines. In this process, we generate the total utility out of marginal utility. Actually, we can figure out marginal utility by knowing total utility first. We can see that marginal utility is actually the difference of two total utilities that are adjacent to each other. For example, the marginal utility of the fourth doughnut can be calculated by subtracting total utility of three doughnuts, which is 24 utils, from total utility of four doughnuts, which is 28. This is what it looks like whenever we write it down. We can summarize the relationship by a formula. Mu represents marginal utility equals the extra utility associated with another item consumed. Here, the triangle-looking thing is delta. It's a distinct symbol representing change in a variable. The denominator Q is the initial for quantity, represents the amount or number of doughnuts. Here, the change in number of doughnuts always increases by 1, conveniently. So the denominator equals 1 all the time in this context. This is everything look like whenever you write down. You can pause and have a look at that. Now, after understanding marginal, we can finally get to the part of how to make an optimal decision with economics in daily life. Let's stick onto the doughnut example. The decision economics try to help us making is how many doughnuts should I eat? From marginal utility, we understand how much we value each doughnut. We quantify the benefits of eating doughnuts. But there is still a piece of information missing. That is cost. We learned cost last class. The number of doughnuts you decide to eat when the doughnut is free of charge will probably be different from the one when the doughnut is $1 per piece, and definitely be different when the price is $5 or more. From learning opportunity cost, we understand that cost of acquiring an item can be different from the price. Even if the doughnut is free of charge, the resource it costs to make the doughnut available to consume is not zero. Actually, we'll learn that marginal cost normally increases in future class. Here, again, for the simplicity of illustration, we assume the cost of eating doughnut is the price. When making a choice, we're weighing the marginal benefit against the marginal cost. We'll choose to do something if the marginal benefit is greater than the marginal cost, because that will help us to maximize the utility. We want to stop at the point when marginal benefit equals marginal cost. When a doughnut is free of charge, that means marginal cost for consuming each additional doughnut is zero. I probably eat 6. If I keep eating, the extra utility is negative, and they will bring the utility down. And when the price is getting higher, the number of doughnuts I'll eat declines. If we assume the marginal utility here is the monetary value, the price of a doughnut is, for example, $6. The crossing point of the two is at 3 doughnuts. Before 3, marginal utility is larger than marginal cost. The gap is called net gain. Excuse me for my handwriting. It adds on to the total benefits. After marginal utility is smaller than marginal cost, the gap is net loss. Or a negative net gain. Total benefit is worse off. So if a person says that's not worth it, they actually are saying the marginal cost is greater than the marginal benefit. Now let's practice. Please pause and resume for explanation. Okay, this question tests the marginal analysis. We should keep conducting an activity as long as the marginal benefit is bigger than the marginal cost, and stops right at the point when the two of them equals each other. If marginal cost is larger than the marginal benefit, then we're doing too much and need to cut back. In this question, the marginal benefit is measured in dollars, and it is a downward sloping curve. While the marginal cost is a constant number of 32. That means the extra cost associated with the opening first hour is 32. And the second hour and the third hour, it is a fixed number in monetary value despite the change of hours open. Then the graphical expression help us to get the answer of 5 hours. Lastly, I would like to clarify the difference between opportunity cost and sunk cost. It's an old saying that don't cry over spilled milk. In making a decision, we use marginal analysis, that is, the incremental benefit and cost associated with a further or ongoing activity. These decisions do not look back to past choices. Sunk costs are the type of costs which are already incurred in past decision and cannot be recovered, should not affect the current decision. Sunk cost is different from fixed cost, which I will cover in firm theory. Here's an example about sunk cost. If you go shopping for a TV set, you drive to the store and do the shopping. The cost of gasoline and the opportunity cost of time making the commute are sunk cost, cannot be recovered. You shouldn't let that influence the decision of whether purchasing a TV or not, although it is hard to do in daily life. Businesses and firms think more about sunk cost. There is a timely example for that in oil industry. Due to a combination of factors such as low demand in pandemic, disruptive activities from petrol regions like Russia and Saudi Arabia, the oil price plunged and fell below zero in April 20, 2020 in the United States. Despite the cost of drilling wells and all costs investing in production capacity, assuming the company is not reselling the equipment in the short run, the extra cost of producing and storing oil is bigger than the extra benefit of doing so. So there are 5 oil companies in Texas decided to stop filing for drilling permits and stop the production. All right, that is all I have for this video. In next class, I will cover definition of several economic terminologies, micro and macroeconomics, positive and normative economics. Why do we need laws or principles of economics like the law of dimensional marginal utility we just learned? And move on to the individual economizing problem using budget line. Thank you for watching. Please like or share the video. And subscribe my channel for more lectures in economics.